Today we shall be talking about the mollusks, wherein we shall be mainly focusing on the general characters of the mollusk. Before proceeding, it is my request to you all to like and subscribe my channel by Learnia and press the bell icon for the latest updates. We are going to talk about the mollusca, which is derived from a Latin word mollis, which means soft body. When we try to define the mollusca, mollusks are bilaterally symmetrical, coelomate protostomia with spiral cleavage and soft unsegmented body, except in the case of monoblacophora, the body is covered by thick muscular fold, that is the mantle, which secretes the single or many shells and a radula in the esophagus, except bivalvia, and the ventral muscular foot for the locomotion. So, when we try to define the mollusks, they are bilaterally symmetrical, that is, their body can be divided into the right and the left house. They are coelomates, that is, they have the true body cavity. Then they are protostomia, it means mouth develops first with the spiral cleavage. And then soft unsegmented body, that is, they don't have the segmentation, that is, their body is not divided into the exact replicas. And then they have a thick muscular fold, which we call it as the mantle. The mantle is a unique feature of the molluscans, which secretes the single or many shells. The shells in the case of mollusca, that can be external, that can be internal. We do mostly encounter the organisms which have the external shells, but octopus such as sepia, such as loligo, they have the internal shells. But talking about the shell, that this is the unique feature, that these very mollusks have the shells in any part of their life cycle, whether the larval or the adult form. Some of the organisms lose the shell in their adult form, whereas it is present in the larval form. Shell is also a unique feature in the case of the mollusk. Radula, it is a rasping organ, that is, it is a ribbon shaped rasping organ. We shall be talking about it in the esophagus, except bivalves, which do not have the radula, and the ventral muscular foot. Muscular foot is also a unique feature of the molluscans, which is adapted for the different kinds of the, you can say, activities. It can be for the creeping, burrowing, sweeping, swimming, leaping. So we shall be talking about this also. So in general, when we talk about the mollusks, the phylum Mollusca includes the soft-bodied invertebrates, such as snails, slugs, mussels, clams, oysters, tusk shells, squids, octopodes, then nautili, etc. This mollusca term was coined by Johnston, and the mollusca is the second largest phyla after Arthropoda. We all know that the phylum Arthropoda is one of the largest phylas, having the maximum number of the organisms, and after the Arthropoda, the mollusca are at the second position in having the number of the organisms. So among mollusca, the class Gastropoda constitute about 80% of all the living mollusks. And the study of the mollusca, it is called as the malacology. When we study mollusks particularly, this very science is called as the malacology. And when we study the shells of the mollusca, and we are expert in studying the shells of the mollusca, we call that very science as the conchology. So This is the basic generalized body plan of the mollusca, wherein we are seeing that this very portion, this is the foot of the mollusca. This is an important distinctive feature. Then what we are seeing here, that this is the visceral hump. This is also called as the mantle. It encloses all the visceral mass. So one important thing in the case of mollusca is that anus and this very mouth, and the many a times the anus, if it is twisted, that comes into the forward position as well. So the maximum, these all the visceral viscera it is enclosed in the visceral hum. And if it is an aquatic mollusk, it has the gills, and if it is a terrestrial mollusk, it contains the pulmonary sac. So this is the diagram which shows the radula. This is the rasping organ, which is called as the radula. So it is used for the biting. It is used for the purpose of the digestion in general. So when we talk about the Ordovician period, it is called as the age of invertebrates, and it is also called as the age of giant mollusks. So Ordovician period of the timeline, we call it as the age of invertebrates, and it is also called as the age of giant mollusks. And the phylum Mollusca is a group of invertebrates which has fascinated the man rightly from the dawn of the civilization. And the man was very much curious about to learn that how these mollusks look like and what are their characteristic features. And Aristotle was the first who tried to classify these mollusks on the basis of the presence or the absence of the shell. Then the members of this group have adapted to for the terrestrial as well as the aquatic environment. So when we talk about the Aristotle, he is called as the father of malacology, as he described many mollusks, especially cephalopods, and divided mollusks into two groups depending on the presence and the absence of the shell, what I was talking about. When we talk about the general characters, so we shall be moving on to the general characters. And the majority of the mollusks, they are aquatic. So one important thing is that the majority of the mollusks are aquatic, and the few are adapted to live in the terrestrial environment. So mostly they are aquatic and the few are terrestrial. So usually snails and slugs, they lead the terrestrial mode of mode of living, and the aquatic mollusks are mostly marine. So when we talk about the aquatic mollusks, mostly they are marine. Few bivalves and the snails inhabit the fresh water or the brackish water. So only a few of them, they reside in the, they have the fresh water or the brackish water as their habitat. They may be found as the hidden parasites into the inside the other organisms as well. So they are free living as well as they are parasitic in nature as well. So as per the estimate, when we talk about that, I told you that these are the second largest phyla after the arthropoda. And according to the Mollusca Base, which is a website which gives us the number of the organisms which have been recorded so far or classified so far. So according to them, the number of the valid recent species is currently estimated around 50,000 to 55,000, which are marine, whereas 25,000 to 30,000, which are terrestrial, and about 6,000 to 7,000, they are freshwater, you can say, mollusks. So this is the data which was collected from the Mollusca. And secondly, they vary in size. It is not like that what we see during mostly that these are the small creatures. No, they are giant in size. They vary in size from the giant squid, such as we are seeing here, that giant squid in relation to the man photographed here. And we can also see the gastropod on the palm of the man. So they vary in size rightly from the giant squids up to the little snails, which can grow up to the millimeters, whereas we do have the giant squids which can grow up to various meters. So we do have these very organisms as the soft. These very organisms are soft, unsegmented. So I was talking about that mostly they are unsegmented, but few, such as monoplacophorans, some of them are segmented. So bilaterally symmetrical, they are coelomates, they are triploblastic, having the organ grade system of organization. So when we talk about their head, they have a distinct head. which has the eyes, which has the mouth, which has the tentacles and the sense organs, except in the case of Pelecypoda and Scaphopoda. When we talk about their exoskeleton, that is the shell that is in the form of the calcareous shell or spicules that is secreted by the mantle. So this very shell is secreted by mantle and is present in most of the, you can say, shell is the characteristic feature of these very mollusks. So it is present in most of them except the ape lacophorans, nudibranchs and most octopus. So the shell is mostly located externally, but many times it can be located internal. What I was telling you, that in the case of sepia and loligo, it is present inside and we call it as the internal shell. And the body is clothed with one layer, which is often ciliated, that is epidermis. So the layer of the body is covered by the epidermis, whereas in some the shell is external, whereas in others the shell may be internal. So when we talk about their digestive system is complete with the digestive gland. So digestive gland, there is it is one that is the liver, and it is collectively with the called as the hepatopancreas, because it has the role of the liver as well as the pancreas. So that is why we call it as the hepatopancreas. And the rasping organ, that is the radula, what I was talking about, this very radula, it is present with transverse rows of teeth. But keep in mind that this very radula is absent in the case of Pelecypoda, that is Pelecypoda. So it is not present in the Pelecypoda. So when we talk about the digestive tract, it is very simple, but the anterior mouth and the posterior anus, what we are seeing here in the case, that is, this is the mouth, this is present at the anterior end, this is the mouth, and this is the anus here, and this is the anus here, that what happens due to the twisting, due to the coiling, the mouth and the anus many a times they come at the anterior side. So in the case of gastropods, scaphopods and cephalopoda, the intestine becomes U-shaped, and thus it brings the intestine or you can say anus in the anterior portion. So in the case of gastropoda, in the case of scaphopods and cephalopods, it is present on the anterior side. So when we talk about the respiratory system, this is the respiratory system, which is mostly called as the gill, molluscan gill, and it is also called as the tenidia or branchi. So in the case of aquatic mollusks, it is the tenidia, which is the respiratory organ, tenidia. So in the case of the terrestrial organisms, it is a pulmonary sac which acts as a lung. So in the case of terrestrial organisms, it is the pulmonary sac, and in the case of the aquatic organisms, it is the tenidia which performs the role of the respiration. And when we talk about the respiration, it takes place by the tenidia. And many a time the cutaneous respiration is also seen. Cutaneous, it means by the skin, respiration is also seen in the case of organisms. And in some cases, the anal respiration, that is, in some cases, the respiration takes place through the anus as well. So we do have the evidences that mostly in the case of aquatic organisms, it is the tenidia. In the case of terrestrial organisms, it is the pulmonary sac. But the evidences of the cutaneous respiration and the anal respiration, they are also present. And secondly, when we talk about the respiratory pigment, and it is hemoglobin is also found in some of the organism in the number of species such as Solan, Arca and Planorbis. But I shall be talking about that. The hemocyanin, it is a copper containing pigment, it is present in most, but here I am talking about the hemoglobin is present in the number of the species such as Solan, Arca and Planorbis, but in the In the coming slides, I shall be talking about that it is mainly hemocyanin which is present as the respiratory pigment in most of the mollusks. So this very circulatory system, the circulatory system is open type and it includes the dorsal pulsatile heart and the few arteries that open into the sinuses. So heart is 2 to 3 chambered, blood is blue. So in some only hemoglobin is present, but in most of the molluscans it is a blue colored pigment called as the hemocyanin which is dissolved in the plasma. So cephalopods have the closed circulatory system whereas others have the open circulatory system. We have to keep in mind that the open as well as the closed circulatory system is seen in the case of mollusca. Closed is only found in the case of the cephalopods, whereas the open in others. Such as here is the diagram which shows that the difference between the open and the closed circulatory system, where the open circulatory system opens directly into the tissue. So what we are seeing here, this is the closed circulatory system which is seen in the case of the cephalopods. And one more important thing, that the blood vascular system, it is the hemocele found in the case of the mollusca, usually in the form of several large connected sinuses which serve as the hydrostatic skeleton, and it also helps in the locomotion in some species. So the two chambered heart, it is situated in the hemocoelomic cavity. So the type of the circulation is open type in most of the molluscans, whereas closed in only cephalopods. And in the open type, the capillaries are absent and the blood bathes the tissue directly. Whereas in the case of closed, it is the capillaries which take up the blood. So we are talking about the excretory system. It is the paired metanephridia. So we are talking about the excretory system, which is paired metanephridia, which is also called as the kidney. It opens into the mental cavity. So these are the kidneys which open into the mental cavity. So in some mollusks, the organ of Bogenus or Kieber's organs, they are also present. They have the role in the excretion. And the excretory matter is ammonia or uric acid. So in the case of mollusca, the excretory matter is ammonia or uric acid. So that is why we call such organisms as the ammonotelic or uricotelic. So the gills, in some cases, the gills also show the excretory function as well. So we do have their nervous system. The nervous system is a little bit advanced in relation to the earlier, the primitive one. So these have the well-defined nervous system with the primitive brain. So herein we do have the primitive brain in most cases, which consists of the circumesophageal nerve ring. So circumesophageal nerve ring is present, and many paired typical ganglia such as cerebral ganglia, visceral ganglia, pleural ganglia, stellate ganglia, optic ganglia and branchial ganglia, such as we do have the commissures also, such as we are in this very portion which connects all the this very branchial nerves. We call it as the interbranchial commissure. So well-defined nervous system is present in the case of the mollusca, wherein we are seeing here the optic ganglia, cerebral ganglia, pleurovisceral ganglia, stellate ganglia, branchial ganglia, gastric ganglia. So the various ganglia, that's branchial ganglia, they are present in the case of the mollusca. So talking about the sense organs, the chemoreceptor or the tactile receptor organs, such as osphradium. So unique feature is that the osphradium is present in the mollusk. It is an organ which is used for testing the physical and the chemical nature of the water. So to detect any physical or the chemical variance in the water, the osphradium is utilized. So osphradium, it is generally located just adjacent to the tinidia. So this is the gill which is called as the tinidia. So here in what we are seeing the Ospidium also. So the Ospidium and the gill, they lie side by side, and this very Ospidium, it helps in the testing of the water in terms of its physical and the chemical nature. So when we talk about the other sense organs, it has well-developed, the eyes are developed, which we call them as the photoreceptors. Then tentacles, these very tentacles are present, which we call them as the tactile receptors. Then they have the balancing organs in the form of the stattocysts. Stattocysts are present in them, so which act as the balancing organs in them. So in most of the mollusks, the stattocysts are also present. So talking about these, their sex, they are usually they are unisexual. So it means that they have the sexes are separate, that is, they are dioecious. So but some hermaphrodites, that is the species, some of the species, they have the both the sexes in one individual as well. That is also present in the few groups. They can be called as the monoecious. So mostly the sexes are separate, but in some cases the hermaphroditism is also found. So mostly the non-marine gastropods and some bivalves and the cephalopods are found to be hermaphrodites. Some non-marine gastropods, some bivalves, and some cephalopods, they are found to be hermaphrodites. Whereas in the case of others, all are found to be having the separate sexes. So fertilization, it can be external or it can be internal. Now, as the student of the biology, you are well aware that mostly in the aquatic organisms, the external fertilization takes place, and mostly in the case of terrestrial organisms, the internal fertilization takes place. So external fertilization takes place in many gastropods and the most bivalves, but the internal fertilization takes place in the non-marine gastropods. So this is the thumbs rule that mostly the aquatic, mostly I'm talking mostly, most of the aquatic organisms do have the external fertilization, whereas most of the maximum of the terrestrial organisms, they show the internal. So this is the foot. The foot is modified in the case of a mollusca, which we call it as the visceral mass on the ventral side. It is utilized as the foot in the case of mollusca. So a ventral muscular foot is present, which helps in locomotion. This very foot helps in the locomotion and may be secondarily modified, and mostly it is modified in some for creeping, for burrowing, for leaping, for swimming, and other activities as well. So foot is also the unique feature of the molluscs. So when we talk about the development, they have the both direct as well as the indirect development. When we talk about the direct development, it means that the fertilized eggs, when they hatch, they directly look like as that of the adult. So they don't have the larval phase. So that is the indirect development, that is the direct development. So in the case of indirect development, the larval phase is there. In the marine and the freshwater forms, development involves two larval stages. One is trochophore larva and other is veliger larva. So this is the trochophore larva and other is veliger larva. So the two larval phases are found in some marine and the freshwater forms. The first larval form is trochophore larva and other larval form is veliger larva. So the molluscans have two larval phases in some, one is trochophore and other is veliger larva. Whereas the direct development mostly takes place in the gastropoda and the mostly takes place in the gastropoda and the cephalopoda. So the direct development takes place in gastropoda and cephalopoda, they don't have any larval stage. Now we shall be talking lastly on the unique features of the mollusca. So when we talk about the unique features, the first and the important thing is that they are soft-bodied, which consists of the head, visceral mass, and the foot. The mantle covers the body. This is the mantle which secretes the shell, and the shell is made up of the conchiolin. Mostly it is made of the conchiolin, which helps to harden the shell. So the buccal cavity has radula in some individuals. Nervous system consists of cerebral, visceral, pleural, and the pedal ganglions. And the trochophore larvae found in some mollusks have been descended from the annelid-like ancestors. So trochophore larva is found in some mollusk, and it is an evidence that the mollusca have been descended from the annelid-like ancestors. So annelids are found to be the ancestors of the molluscans. But how they have advanced from the molluscans? Now, what is the advancement of the molluscans over the annelida? So this is the advancement that they have a distinct head. Now, the distinct head is present in most of the molluscans. Well-dwelled gills are present for the aquatic respiration, and pulmonary sac in the case of aerial respiration. This is the advancement over the annelida. So muscles are arranged in bundles. In bundles, the muscles are arranged which are used to move some specific parts. And well-dwelled sense organs, that is eyes, statocysts, Ospreidia. I told you that they are the they are for the physical and the chemical detection. So they are just present near the tinnidia, and they are used to detect any variation in the water in terms of their physical nature as well as the chemical nature. So mostly the ganglionated nervous system, this is also a unique characteristic feature and advancement over the annelida, that ganglionated nervous system and the ganglia having the tendency to become concentrated at the anterior end. So now the ganglia, they have become concentrated at the anterior end, and thus acting as a somewhat kind of a primitive brain. So this is advancement over the annelida. So this was all about the mollusca, their general characteristic features. You enjoyed the lecture, and thank you very much for listening. It is my request to you all to like and subscribe the channel BioLearnia, and also press the bell icon to get the latest updates. Thank you.